Hey guys, in this video, I'm going to analyze a Jordan Peterson interview, the one that got him famous and blew him up across the internet. Peterson is a clinical psychologist and professor of psychology at the University of Toronto who gained notoriety due to his controversial views regarding social matters and society. His conservative, right-wing stance and reactionary politics have made him highly appealing, especially to young men. As a lifestyle guru to lots of young people, his main stance is that the competitive, free market, capitalist system, especially the Western neoliberal model, is the ideal setting upon which to run a society, and that individual self-determination is the key to success within this system. He argues that there is a biological determinism to class hierarchy, it is part of our genetic makeup, and that it is in our benefit to maintain a system that is based explicitly on social inequality, and therefore things like government assistance and social safety nets are a burden on society. According to his morally relativistic viewpoint, if you are poor or suffering in any way under the system, the problem is not society's design, but rather your mindset. Here, he's being interviewed by Cathy Newman on issues such as the gender pay gap and whether we have a male-dominated world or not. Now, I consider myself a structuralist and a systems thinker, and from my analysis, capitalism is an inefficient system that is outdated and problem-producing, since it is predicated on old-world notions that do not fit into the scheme of things in the 21st century. I advocate for a new social and economic model which offers a worldview that is far different from the age-old capitalist-communist duality that has been dominating intellectual discussions for generations. And for those of you who have not been following my channel, especially Jordan Peterson fans, I want to make it clear, although there are positives in what Peterson says about people needing to own up, have discipline, and structure in their lives, individual willpower can only get us so far in an economic system that limits one's opportunities due to artificial scarcity and competitive hierarchy. The data that I've collected on these issues makes it clear to me that class hierarchy is unhealthy and unproductive, and that we no longer have to have a culture where people's success have to come at the expense of others. My main criticism of his perspective and people who think like him is that they do not take a true sociological and historically accurate account of human behavior, but rather a highly flawed, socially Darwinistic view that is elitist and favors those at the very top of the pyramid. If you have a dysfunctional social system, you're gonna have dysfunctional people within it, and people on average will behave in relation to what is reinforced by the social structures that make up society. Now, one final note. Cathy Newman does not do a good job in this interview. She starts attacking him from the very beginning, trying her best to antagonize him, which actually makes her look bad and makes him look pretty damn likable. Although she makes good points about the existence of gender inequality, she does not advocate for general income equality. I strive for a world that is about general human equality and human rights, while encouraging people to express their individuality within the sphere of cultural and environmental sustainability. Anyway, with all that covered, let's start the interview.
Jordan Peterson, you've said that men need to, quote, grow the hell up. Tell me why.
There's nothing good about it. People who don't grow up don't find the sort of meaning in their life that sustains them through difficult times, and they are certain to encounter difficult times, and of no use to themselves and of no use to anyone else and no partner for a woman, and there's nothing in it that's good.
So you say, I mean, that sounds pretty bad. You're saying there's a crisis of masculinity? I mean, what do you do about it?
Okay, so I assume by grow up, he means for people to adopt responsibility, hold themselves more accountable, and work harder towards their goals, which I completely agree with. But where I differ with all this is in realizing the impact of culture and society on people's attitudes and sense of self. It should be no mystery how much of a role culture really plays on human behavior, as well as the many subcultures and nuances that are expressed in different forms. While most people understand to some degree how we are influenced by our surroundings, they really don't take into account the largest order structural factors that could be affecting their lives without them even knowing about it. And as I'll try to make the case, if we improve the culture and environment in which people live, they will also improve as human beings.
You help people understand why it's necessary and important for them to grow up and adopt responsibility, why that isn't a shake your finger and get your act together sort of thing, but why it's more like a delineation of the kind of destiny that makes life worth living. What I've been telling young men is that there's an actual reason why they need to grow up, which is that they have something to offer. People have within them this capacity to set the world straight, and that's necessary to manifest in the world, and that also doing so is where you find the meaning that sustains you in life.
Yes, people do have the capacity to do great things in life, but only if they are products of a healthy environment. All people, regardless of color or creed, have certain immutable needs. Things like food, shelter, safety from harm, meaningful work and education, and a decent family life. And I say that our economic system has failed terribly, and meeting human needs across the board. People are not being brought up in the conditions that would allow them to thrive and succeed in life. When 50% of the world's population lives on less than $5 a day, and 3.4 billion struggle to meet their basic life needs, and when in the US, home of the American dream, 63% of Americans don't have enough savings to cover even a $500 emergency charge, what is that supposed to tell us about our system? In this world, money brings you resources that translate to a better life. About 21% of children in the US, 15 million, live in impoverished families. And growing up poor is one of the strongest determining factors of child abuse and neglect. The toxic stress experienced by those living in poverty translates to frustration for parents that could lead to maltreatment of their children. The Adverse Childhood Experiences study has shown how every single childhood stressor can greatly impact the health and overall well-being of an individual throughout their lifespan. Deprivation is the root source of crime, mood and behavioral disorders, among other things, even so-called laziness. And don't forget that we currently live in an age where technology can allow us to produce an abundance of food and material goods to ensure that no one is deprived. Yet, due to the prevailing logic of our labor for income system, those who do not earn money should not be given what they need, even if the jobs are no longer there. So it's a socially inefficient system. And while there are always exceptions to the rule, and many people can overcome their limitations and succeed in life, that is a very small number compared to the statistical average. Therefore, until we can design a society that more efficiently meets people's needs, self-help can only take us so far.
Women deeply want men who are competent and powerful. And I don't mean power in that they can exert tyrannical control over others. That's not power. That's just corruption. Power is competence.
True power is competence, and I personally view people who are competent problem solvers to be powerful individuals. Peterson has a book called 12 Rules for Life, which is about instilling moral virtues into people. And I'd say good luck in expecting people to follow these rules if they are abused products. Again, I agree with many of his points, but the problem is people do not live in a vacuum, but rather a continuum of pressures and influences. Now, I say that we need to be pushing for a world that removes unnecessary and artificial stressors from people's lives so that they have the capacity, the chance, to make the right decisions in life. And going back to competence, what good is it to demand competence from people while not having an equal expectation of competence from our social system? During a pandemic where people have lost their jobs and livelihood, the governments of the West, such as the US, bailed out failing corporations and banks while mere crumbs were given to average people. No universal healthcare, no nothing. Even Canada's government has done the same, giving money to those who could afford a loss while ignoring the needs of the most vulnerable. Is that competence? Was it competent for the US government to cut funds for the Pandemic Preparedness Office in order to save money? What does it say about the competence of a global system that is more willing to go to war rather than to spend that same money on education or social reform? I mean, if we're going to hold people so accountable to doing the right thing, how about we start from the very foundation of our society and work our way up from there? And here's one of the most important parts of the interview, where Cathy Newman challenges Peterson on whether we still have a patriarchal society and whether men are still favored in the workplace or not.
Simple question. Is gender equality a myth in your view? Is that something that's just never going to happen? Here in the UK, for example, let's take that as an example. The gender pay gap stands at just over 9%. You've got women at the BBC recently saying that the broadcaster is illegally paying them less than men to do the same job. So it seems to a lot of women that they're still being dominated and excluded, to quote your words back to you.
There's a personality trait known as agreeableness. Agreeable people are compassionate and polite. And agreeable people get paid less than less agreeable people for the same job. Women are more agreeable than men.
So according to him, women have this inborn characteristic that makes them more agreeable than men. And this contributes to the gender pay gap. And that it's up to them to be more aggressive and fight harder to get what they want. But is it that cut and dry? Do we all need to tap into that aggressive, inborn nature of ours to succeed in our society? Or are we simply being forced to abide by certain cultural rules that have been imposed upon us? Let us look at the historical data regarding gender roles. It has been discovered that before the dawn of agriculture, prehistoric societies had an egalitarian makeup, and that women had much more involvement in decision-making and leadership, suggesting that inequality was an aberration that came with the advent of farming and land ownership. So there's a clear cultural factor that has been somewhat ignored or conveniently dismissed. Rhianne Eisler's book, The Chalice and the Blade, provides evidence that for the past several thousand years, history has been written and rewritten by men in power so that power structures that support them can continue to exist. The Neolithic Revolution had many benefits, such as the surplus production of food and the evolution of technology. but it also signaled the end of the egalitarian setting of hunter-gatherers, transitioning us from societies based on collaboration, trust, and the sharing of resources to private property and land ownership, where governments and armies were erected to defend the property of the rich and powerful. This organization was also expressed at the gender level. The sex that could monopolize resources could also take charge of territories, family life, and ultimately control the opposite sex. And so, it was inevitable that in a system which enforced rigid social hierarchies, men would gain control through violence and oppression. This is why, generally, masculine values in our culture are strength, aggression, and independence, and women are assigned the aspects of humanity that are opposite, emotional expression, submissiveness, and the like. But these qualities are not inherent to either men or women. They are assigned to them based on the dominant cultural ideology. So while there may be a genetic component that makes women more agreeable in order to reduce conflict, we cannot overlook the effect of culturally prescribed gender roles. Agreeableness should be a desirable quality. It means the ability to work with others and be more cooperative, and to settle things diplomatically. Finland's new government is led by young women, and they seem to be doing pretty good. The country has some of the best income equality in the world, and has exceptionally high achievements in health and education, which has contributed to women's high economic and political participation. And that's the point. Income equality actually makes society more functional and productive. Now, Cathy Newman doesn't seem to understand the cultural and economic factors behind all this, and she's simply making a scapegoat out of men, making sexist and power-hungry men to be the main issue, and ignoring the underlying systemic forces that perpetuate this tendency. By the way, income inequality is the greatest source of social destabilization in the world, and it is also responsible for the diminishment of not only women's rights, but other groups as well.
I mean, to get to the top of any organization is an incredibly competitive enterprise. And the men that you're competing with are simply not going to roll over and say, please take the position.
So let me come back to my question.
It's absolute all-out warfare.
Yep, he's absolutely right. It is all-out warfare to get to the top of this pyramid. You know the whole notion of the alpha male, the asshole who stomps on anyone and everyone on their way to the top? We live in a culture that is all about winning, not about doing what's right. In any sensible society, a true alpha male or female would be the one who helps uplift others and improve their lives. There have been a fair number of studies demonstrating that those who have issues of psychopathy do better in business, since good business etiquette requires a lack of remorse or feelings of guilt.
Is gender equality desirable?
If it means equality of outcome, then almost certainly it's undesirable. That's already been demonstrated in Scandinavia, because in Scandinavia...
What do you mean by that? Equality of outcome is undesirable?
Well, men and women won't sort themselves into the same categories if you leave them alone to do it off their own accord. I've already seen that in Scandinavia. It's 20-1 female nurses to male, and approximately the same male engineers to female engineers. And that's a consequence of the free choice of men and women in the societies that have gone farther than any other societies to make gender equality the purpose of the law.
People really overlook the powerful role of traditionally imposed gender roles and how much of an influence they've had on male and female occupational selection. Recent discoveries have shown that in the Americas, between 40 to 50% of big game hunters were actually female. And while male nurses seem to be an anomaly, the perception that nursing is a female profession is far from a natural conclusion. Truth is that for a long while, Western culture had essentially excluded women from most professions seen as too masculine. Jobs such as nursing were seen as occupations or pastimes that were suitable to a woman's primary cultural role as a caregiver of a family. Again, the underlying cultural currents of our society are overtly ignored and dismissed by people like Peterson.
Right, so you're saying that anyone who believes in equality, whether you call them feminists, call them whatever you want to call them, should basically give up because it ain't going to happen. So the simple question is, do you believe in equal pay?
Well, I made the argument there. It's like it depends on
who
defines
it. So you don't believe in equal pay?
No, I'm not saying that at all.
You know, I really don't like this kind of divisive communication by her, where she keeps reframing what Peterson is saying and restating it in a way that comes out negative. She's not behaving professionally. Why don't you let the guy finish his point before projecting negativity onto him? And here we are with the most cliche statement of the entire interview. Peterson's rebuttal as to why we should not interfere with the free market.
There was a huge debate in Canadian society at that point that was basically ran along the same lines as your argument, is that if the law firms didn't use these masculine criteria, then perhaps women would do better. But the market sets the damn game. In a chess game, right, there's lots of things that you can do, although you can't break the rules of the chess game and continue to play chess.
There's this myth that the free market system is self-driven and governed by an invisible hand, which actually lends to superstitious and religious thinking. Well, the truth is that the market is operated and driven by people, and this is a society run by the ultra-rich. You might remember that Citigroup document that was leaked back in 2005. It described the US, UK, and Canada as plutonomies, countries where rule by an ultra-rich managerial class has replaced democracy. A study was done years ago by the mathematics department of Tufts University, conducting a formal analysis of market-driven behavior to see whether inequality and poverty were avoidable in a market system. And after careful review, the researchers concluded that wealth inequality is not only inevitable, but that the end result of any market system is oligarchy, where one player ends up with all the money while everyone else has virtually nothing. For anyone interested in the details of how the study was done, I've included links in the video description. Capitalism is a social design that mathematically guarantees inequality and oligarchy, and until we revise the structure, it's going to stay this way and actually get much, much worse. Now, here in this final segment, Peterson argues in favor of inequality in a hierarchy based on the notion of biological determinism, suggesting that human hierarchies are a result of evolution and that any attempt to alter them is doomed to failure.
There's this idea that hierarchical structures are a sociological construct of the Western patriarchy, and that is so untrue that it's almost unbelievable. And I use the lobster as an example. We divulged from lobsters in evolutionary history about 350 million years ago. And lobsters exist in hierarchies, and they have a nervous system attuned to the hierarchy.
I don't know where to even begin with this one, but first of all, human lineage diverged from arthropods long before lobsters evolved. And lobster hierarchy clearly developed independently of any human societal structures. Second, lobsters are invertebrates, while humans are vertebrates. Two completely separate groups on the phylogenetic tree, and they diverged around 500 million years ago. Even conservative estimates show that the vertebrate branch of the phylogenetic tree diverged hundreds of millions of years before the emergence of the proto-lobster. And human hierarchical structures are nothing like those of lobsters. Lobsters are obviously extremely basic animals with a very simple brain, much more influenced by body chemistry, and their hierarchy is determined by body size and aggression. Clearly, humans can and have organized their leaderships throughout history in various ways that are far different than simply who's the biggest and strongest. The existence of art, music, science, and literature all make Jordan Peterson's comparisons to lobsters utterly silly and ignorant. Yes, we have what's called the limbic system, which triggers our fight and flight response for survival. But due to the development of the neofrontal cortex, humans have had the ability to think and organize differently than primitive creatures like the lobsters. It is our current culture and economic system that brings out the worst behaviors in us. The main emotional reactions that capitalism triggers are fear and greed due to the perpetuation of artificial scarcity. These are not immutable built-in behaviors, but rather incentives that are driven by our socioeconomic orientation.
The idea of hierarchy has absolutely nothing to do with sociocultural construction.
Let me just get this straight. You're saying that we should organize our societies along the lines of the lobsters.
She's definitely right to mock him on this one. I mean, Peterson sure likes to pick and choose whatever information pushes forth his narrative, a narrative that is clearly biased and favored by all the free market priests, from Thomas Malthus and his theory of overpopulation to Adam Smith's invisible hand of the market. Look, these people were not scientists. They made highly uneducated assumptions regarding the state of the world, which justified and legitimized an established system that favored power and moneyed interests. And honestly, the ideas would be and should be laughed at by any critical thinking mind of today. And if we're going to use lobsters to support the idea of hierarchy, then how about we look at the closest genetic relatives to humans? Chimps and bonobos share 99% of their genome with humans. However, they display far different behaviors from one another. Chimps have highly brutal social hierarchies dominated by males, similar to that of post-agriculture humans. Bonobos, on the other hand, live in egalitarian societies that are governed by females, substituting sex for aggression. And what makes a difference? The environment. Chimps generally live in climates where fruit availability fluctuates radically, and therefore strict hierarchies must be maintained in order to manage scarcity. Bonobos live in lush rainforest regions that have an abundance of fruit, and similar to our hunter-gatherer ancestors, which actually allows for a vast range of behaviors and social organization. So although they are very similar in genetic structure, they are nothing alike in behavior, and that cannot be explained by mere biology.
One thing we can't do is say that hierarchical organization is a consequence of the capitalist patriarchy. It's like, that's patently absurd. It's wrong. It's not a matter of opinion. It's seriously wrong.
I mean, I really don't understand how this guy could gain such popularity, other than the fact that our culture breeds this type of narrow-minded thinking, and people who have been bombarded with misinformation are looking to further confirm their biases by turning to people like him. As long as we keep putting our faith in the hands of these so-called academics and self-help gurus, society will continue to walk blindly towards the path of self-destruction. While I'm all in support of the idea of self-development, we also need to develop a sense of social awareness and to realize that no man is an island. We all need each other to survive, and it truly takes a village, a nation, and a global consciousness to raise a child. Peace out.